interfacing of the process, right, with the memory and the peripheral I/O device. So what is interfacing? Interfacing or nothing but how the microprocessor communicates with other devices, external devices. In that memory also will come under that. So for example, as a human being, we communicate with the outside world through our eyes, ears, we listen through our ears, and we communicate with our mouth. Okay, so this is our output, whereas ears are input devices. Okay, then we have our hand, where we write something and we show it to the others, or to normally that we do something, or that's a communication with our hands. So we communicate with the outside world through our eyes, ears. We see many things in our ears. Then we process those things in our brain. So to brain is, if we take brain as a microprocessor, these are all the eyes, ears, nose, mouth, hands, legs. These are all the communication, external communication. Okay, we send something and we send it to the brain, where the brain process, and the output will be given through our mouth, through our hands, through our legs, etc. So our body has its own I/O devices, input and output devices. Like that, the microprocessor, if we take CPU as the brain of the computer, a microprocessor, then memory is one external device, okay, where you store the data. Likewise, peripheral I/O, that is input output device. A pen drive is an I/O device, hard disk is an external device, and then mouse, keyboard, all those things, the monitor, all are I/O devices. How they are connected to the CPU? So the CPU, how communicate with all these devices, including the main memory? This is to be interfacing. So how it communicate? That has to be a common a control lines, or through which it can communicate with them. So how we correctly identify which is the device it wants to communicate. So all those things only we are going to see. So memory is a place where we store the data and retrieve the data. The performance of a computer system depends upon the size of the primary memory. If it has more memory, then the processing power also, and if it has more processing power, good processing power, then it can store more data and process more data. So this, it depends upon the size of the primary memory. So when I say memory, it is broadly divided into two. One is primary memory and secondary memory. The primary memory is a volatile memory. This is nothing but RAM and ROM. Read-only memory and random access memory, where the first the data from the secondary storage. When I say secondary storage, it is nothing but your C drive or D drive, whatever it is, okay? And then pen drive. All those things comes under the secondary storage, bulk storage. So even our operating system is storing C drive only. So when the system is on, when you switch on the system, what happens? The operating system from the secondary storage is loaded into the main memory, which is very close to the CPU. If we see our microprocessor architecture, the previous classes, we have, along with the 40 pins configuration, we have memory also. So the memory is somewhat very close to the CPU. It is directly connected to the CPU. Memory is directly connected, the main memory, not all memory, only the RAM, random access memory, otherwise we call it as primary memory, otherwise we call it as memory. It is connected to the microprocessor, the CPU, through control signals, address bus, data bus, through all these things, it is connected. Whereas within CPU, the internal registers, they are all connected as and out as a single unit. Whereas the memory is somewhat outside of CPU, but information will be taken from this memory only, main memory only, and it will be processed in the CPU, and then again the temporary data will be stored back in the main memory. So before you do all those, you quit the system or shut down the system, what we will be doing, we will save it, we will press the save button to any interface. If I drop in a turbo C compiler, what I will do, I will start open. First turbo C compiler will be loaded. So where it is coming, it is coming from the secondary storage only. So when I say I click on the turbo C compiler, then it will open, it will load the compiler from the secondary storage into the main memory. Then in main memory we have the turbo C compiler. Then in that interface you go to the file open and open the particular file. So when you give the particular file, you will give all the folder, the full path. So normally the path will be from our C or D drive where you have stored your C program. Then you load it. Once you open it, it will be loaded into the interface. Okay, which is nothing but again your main memory only. Then you execute the program, you do some modifications, everything, or you create new programs, etc. So before leaving, what you will be doing, you will save the program. So when I say save, it again asks for the path, it will ask for a file name and a path. So you will be giving the file path. So that mostly that will be in your secondary storage. So in that, you give the file name as with the .c extension, and then you will store it in a folder. This is what happens. So when you save it, it means you are saving it into the secondary storage. Okay, till that you will be working in a temporary memory called main memory. So that is what our random access memory. And this only has close connections with the CPU. The secondary storage is not connected directly with the central processing unit. So what the computer or the microprocessor will do, when you boot the system and when you start loading some interface like C++ or Java program, whatever it is, Genie, whatever it is, when you give a open, at that time only the data from the secondary storage will be loaded into the main memory, and it uses the main memory space, it executes, and then once when you give the save, then the data will be saved into the secondary storage. So once you store the data in the secondary storage, it will be permanently there till you delete the data. So that is why, and even if the power goes, when the next time you log in your system and you open and load the data or that particular file again, you will find it there. So secondary storage is a permanent memory. Even if you switch off and then the power goes, next time when you switch on the system, you can load the latest version of your program which you have stored. So that is because it is a non-volatile memory. This is the non-volatile. Secondary storage is a non-volatile because the meaning, even if the power goes, the data will be stored. Which means if you have saved the data only, it will be there. Okay. But in the main memory, when you are working on file, when the power goes, everything on the main memory, it doesn't have the capacity to store the data. So that is why it is called volatile memory or temporary memory. And since it is closely connected to the CPU, we call it as a main memory and drive memory. Why the name main memory? Any processing, any processing of data, first it has to be brought to the main memory from the secondary storage. Because the main memory only has access to the all the CPU registers and all the internal registers of the CPU, arithmetic, logic unit, to all these things, only the main memory is connected, not the secondary storage. So any data first has to be loaded into the main memory. From there, it will be processed by the CPU, and then again it will be written back into the secondary storage. This is how the computer works. So interfacing is a technique. So when I say this, memory is another difference. Secondary storage is another. So when I come to the secondary storage, I call it as an I/O device. Whereas main memory, since it is closely connected, that we call it as a, there are two types of interfacing, memory interfacing and I/O interfacing. Now, when I say memory interfacing, we are talking only about the main memory connection with the CPU. Okay. So in general, RAM or ROM is used for memory interfacing. Memory is a digital, again, it is a heritage chip. Store the data in the binary format. So memory is made up of just now whatever I have said and given here. Memory is made up of sympathetic to vegetables to show the programs and data. The memory is broadly divided into primary and secondary. The types is RAM, ROM, EEPROM, all those things comes under this. Microprocessor uses it in storing a program temporarily and executing the program. The speed of this is fast. As it is connected to the CPU directly, the speed of this memory will be very fast than the secondary storage. So it is slower, secondary storage is slower because anything is first has to be brought into the main memory, and from main memory only the CPU will access. The CPU is not connected directly to the secondary storage, so it will be a slower device and it is a non-volatile. So examples of the block diagram, let us consider this as an 8085 is a microprocessor and this is our main memory, that is primary memory. So how it is connected through the address line and data line. The same address lines we call it as a data line because address lines are 16 bits. Within that 8 bits will be the data line because 8 bits are the bidirectional. Whereas when you combine all 16 address lines for placing of address, it will be unidirectional. And then we have control lines where we have IO, W bar, IO, slash, M bar signals, or read signals, write signals, all those signals we call it comes under a control line. And this together we call it as an interface because through this only they communicate. Okay, this 8085 is communicating with memory through these lines only, and this we call it as an interface. So whatever I have said previous slide, that's what given here to be clearly. Higher order address is equal to 8085 divided by this 8087. So ALE is address latch enabled, IO latch enabled, RD bar enabled, these are some of the control signals. So when I say higher order, from this to this, A0 to A7 is called as lower order, and AA to A15 is called as a higher order. Address bus is together we call it as address bus, and it is of 16 bit data is the used to address memory and IO devices. And data bus is 8 bit. Only this will be based in database and this is 8-bit and this is bidirectional. So demultiplexing of address and data line. What is meant by demultiplexing? When I place the data on the data line, demultiplexing refers to separating address and data signal for read and write operation. Okay, separate. Because the same lines will be used for both reading and writing. Okay, it is used for both placing the address as well as data. So at what time when the same lower order 8 bits are used as address or used as data, at what time both will be separated? That is called demultiplexing. So demultiplexing refers to separating address and data for read and write operation. For example, here 20 and 05. This is the, let us imagine, this is the address. Okay. So now it will be based on that 0005. So this is the memory address. This is the memory address. So here 20 higher order is based on A15 and A07 05 is based. Then it goes that read the data from 2005, it is nothing but 4 attacks. While reading, this 4 attacks is based on the same, okay, the same A0 to A7. But now we call it as a data, as a D0 to A7. And it will be read by the 8085 by giving the read signal. So, memory chip, let us say example with the memory chip of a read write static memory. Here, 2048 is the number of registers present in this memory, where each register can store 8 bit of data. So, which means what is the memory capacity? It is nothing but 2048. The 2048 registers are there, which means that you can imagine that not that much lines are there. So, 2048 into 8, that is the capacity of this read write memory. That is how you calculate the memory.
don't have to say something. Now, this hack, in order to address each individual 2048 line, 2048 registers, now we need 2 power 11, which is nothing but 2048. It can represent individually 2048 lines, which is nothing but it needs 11 address line. So, address line is A0 to A10. It needs this much of address line. So, the number of address line needed exactly for an individual addressing the lines in the particular chip depends upon the number of lines in the particular chip. So, if here 2048 lines are there, means we need only 11 address lines, which can individually address each individual lines of this 2048 line. Now, it has a chip select, it has a read signal and a write signal, or different, all of low active signals. Then, here input buffer and output buffer is there. Input buffer, it will be enabled by this write signal. Because when it wants to write something into the memory, the input buffer will be enabled. And when it wants to read from this memory, RD bar will be enabled. It will make this output buffer to be enabled. And we have the A0 to A10, where whatever the data present in these lines, the internal decoder will decode and it will correctly find out the respective line, individual line, and that data will be based in output buffer, which will be read by this, which will be where it will be enabled by the read signal, and the data from that is placed on the data bus. Now, here, this is another example. We have an EEPROM memory chip. This is a read write memory, and this is a memory chip. Of EEPROM, it is read-only memory, erasable, programmable, read-only memory. So here, what we have is 40. You can see that 4096 is the capacity into 8. It is memory capacity. In order to individually access the line 4096, how you can represent it? 2 power 12. That is 12 address lines are needed. So A0 to A11. This means address lines it is needed in order to generate individual unique lines, addresses. Okay, so here, since it is a read only memory, you can read only. So only read signal is there. There is no write signal. So RD bar, and it is a output buffer, and a output buffer. So it will enable the output buffer. The individual line will be read and placed on the door. Which in turn will be placed on the database. And in order to select this chip, we have CS. But it is nothing but chip select low active. So, what happens once the data is written in that? It can be erased because it doesn't make erasable programmable rewriting memory. Once it is written, it can be the data inside that can be changed only by the program developer or the manufacturer who manufactured this chip. So how they write, if they want to erase some particular line or the whole line or write something new, again they have to pass some ultraviolet rays on this quartz. This is a quartz window. So in this they pass ultraviolet rays, which in turn will erase all the data. Then after that they will write the data, and then again there will be a sticker will be placed so that unknowingly or knowingly it will not be erased by the user. It cannot be overwritten once it is done. Only it can be done by the manufacturer.